The 18th century ushered in profound changes in the practice of dentistry, the impetus for which came from the scientific discoveries of the preceding century. Dentistry ultimately became an independent scientific discipline, not overnight, however, but after much painstaking experimentation and dedicated effort on the part of several generations of practitioners. By the beginning of the century, France had become the most civilized and cultured country in Europe, and surgery was one of the many fields in which this superiority was reflected. Medicine, however, still languished far behind. By about 1725, the surgeons of the College de Sainte-Comme had publicly demonstrated their independence from the physicians, and they themselves lobbied for legislation to regulate the practice of surgery. In 1699, the French Parliament passed a law stipulating that dental practitioners, or experts pour la dent, along with such other specialists as oculists and bone setters, had to be examined by a committee of surgeons before being allowed to practice in Paris and its environs. In other countries, too, a sincere attempt was made about this time to protect the people by regulation from harmful mistreatment by quacks. 14 years before France, as Professor Walter Hoffmann Axthelm has rightfully pointed out, the German state of Brandenburg-Prussia passed an edict regulating the practice of Collegium Medicum in Berlin, and what physicians as well as apothecaries and surgeons are to observe. All those who wished to practice dentistry were obliged to appear before a government commission in order to receive a license. When oculists, operators, lithotomists, hernia operators, tooth growers, and etc. wished to advertise themselves and wish publicly to practice and offer for sale their art and science, then they should be inhibited by this collegio, no less than the magistrate, in submitting to their examinations, whereupon depending on the result, they should be permitted or forbidden to do so. Hoffmann Axthelm points out that the edict made a sharp distinction between frauds and quacks and valid operators in stating that the former should be tolerated nowhere and suppressed with unrelenting harsh punishment. Unfortunately, these regulations established in France, Germany, and elsewhere were rarely enforced and quacks and charlatans abounded. In France, one of the most notorious of these was a huge man known far and wide as Le Grand Thomas, or Great Thomas, who plied his trade in Paris on the Pont Neuf. His flamboyant showmanship attracted much attention, and many contemporary drawings of him exist. Modern dentistry owes its greatest debt to a remarkable Frenchman who synthesized what was known in the West about dentistry and who presented it in an organized form so that all practitioners could benefit. Pierre Fauchard was born in Brittany in 1678. After training as a military surgeon, he settled about 1719 in Paris, where he remained until his death in 1761. In 1723, he completed his epic work, Le Chirurgien Dentiste Outre de Dent, or The Surgeon Dentist, or Treatise on the Teeth, which, however, was not published until 5 years later, in 1728. A second edition was brought out in 1764, and it contained more material and more better illustrations than the first Le Chirurgien Dentiste. 863 pages in two small volumes was the most important book on dentistry to appear, and it was to remain the authoritative work in the field during the next century. Issued in German translation in 1733, it became available in English only in 1946, when the great dental historian Lillian Lindsay completed a translation. In Forshaw's day, it was customary for practitioners of any of the healing arts to guard their knowledge and skills jealously. But Forshaw despised such secrecy and, to his own financial detriment, made his method publicly, saying, "I have perfected and also invented several artificial pieces of tooth for substituting a part of the teeth and for remedying their entire loss. And to the prejudice of my own interests, I now give the most exact description possible of them." A large portion of Le Chirurgien Dentiste is devoted to practical operative dentistry. Here, Forshaw detailed his method of removing caries from a tooth and filling the cavity with lead or tin. Forshaw's understanding of periodontal disease was well in advance of his time. He was a firm believer in scaling the teeth and debridement of smooth surfaces to prevent gingival disease. A strong advocate of preventive dentistry, he recommended the use of mouthwashes as part of home care and gave many formulas for concocting them. It astounds us to read that this advanced thinker firmly believed that one should rinse one's mouth every morning with several spoons of one's own freshly voided urine in order to ensure good health. Forshaw gave much practical advice and illustrated his book with excellent drawings both of the instruments he devised and of his prosthetic appliances. And he brought a new dignity and decorum to the dentist's office by insisting that instead of sitting on the floor with the dentist standing over him, the patient be seated in an armchair which is steady and firm, suitable and comfortable. The back of which should be horsehair with a soft pillow raised more or less according to the stature of the person and particularly to that of the dentist. Forshaw won great fame and respect in his lifetime. He effectively separated dentistry from the larger field of surgery, even more emphatically from the trade of the tooth drawers, and set it on its own feet as an independent profession, with its own circumscribed field duties and services and its own name. It was Forshaw who coined the term surgeon dentist, which is what French call their dentist to this day. No one has made a more perceptive evaluation of Pierre Fauchard's achievement than the great American dentist Chapin A. Harris. Considering the circumstances under which he lived, Fauchard deserves to be remembered as a noble pioneer, a sure founder of dental science. That his practice was crude was due to his times, that it was scientific and comparatively superior, and successful was due to himself.